Okay. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to Mind Heist episode 135. 135. Back in the studio, bro.
Wow.
Back in the studio.
Wow. Look at that. With the sponsorships behind you. I can see those books.
Oh, you know what? That book was gone and I see my wife's repositioned it. You know what, bro? Someone told her actually that they bought the book because they saw it in the podcast.
That's it. Royalties now, bro. That's it.
Yes. I have to take... What should I do, bro? 10%? 15%?
Nah, just in cooking, bro. Portion sizes. Yeah, that's what it is.
Understood, yes.
Extra meat in your... I don't know.
Daddy gets a big chicken leg. Yeah.
That's it, bro.
Yeah, man. Alhamdulillah. So, inshallah, the sound's going to be better now that I'm here. And... inshallah, next episode should look a little bit different as well, a little bit better. Bro, look at that. My mustache is like, it's like all gone. And my beard's like, you know what? I've never traveled with a beard this long, I don't think.
Really?
And it was nerve-wracking.
I don't know, really. I don't know what it's like. I mean, like, I suppose Turkey, isn't it? Going back into Turkey.
Yeah, I don't
when
think
I went to Turkey, it was a bit
Turkey cares.
Really?
It's more like going into the UK, maybe. But, bro, your wife has niqab, right? So it's like you can't escape.
Going into the UK is easy, but going anywhere else has always been a problem. Always.
Really, yeah?
Mm. Yeah, going into Turkey when I went, I don't know how many years ago, that was a problem. Yeah. Mm. I had people waiting for me, and then I had people waiting for me outside.
Really?
All sorts. Mm. Yeah, they were taking this photos of my stuff and sending it on WhatsApp.
Sending it to you? Like their superior,
I don't know, some plain clothes officers or something. They were taking photos of my passport and stuff, and I could see him sending it to people on WhatsApp.
Wow.
And I was just like, nice. I could see him waiting at the end of the queue. Yeah. I could see him waiting at the end of the queue, and I was like, is he there? He's there for me, isn't he? Wow. Got there. That's exactly what happened.
Yeah, wow. Well. Yeah, I got stopped here as well before. I think it was 2013. Hmm. So it was like the height of the ISIS kind of period.
Yeah, it's probably close to that kind of time.
But just like I feel okay coming here because when I see the amount of people like with big beards or the amount of people that are very, you know, they hold certain views and they got getting visas and all that, it's like I don't feel like that's an issue. But when you come into the UK, maybe because I know the UK a bit better in terms of the security system, it's like after passport control, there's always that one guy there just waiting to pick someone randomly, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I know that guy, if he doesn't get the answers he likes, he can turn that into schedule 7 or whatever.
I suppose I'm very biased when it comes to coming into the UK because you know, for the past 4 or 5 years I've been in that kind of field of work, so I'm comfortable answering any questions I've got. You know, I could just say Google me, you'll find me, don't worry about me. Do you know what I mean? I'm fine
as long as they don't Google Achi tweet.
Well, this is it. I always have to double check what email I give out. Otherwise, I just see all my tweets and memes. Like, is this who he says he is? Is this guy who says he is?
Yeah. Oh, wow. Yeah. It's true, though. Like, I think what I've always heard is the good policy is literally be very open. You know, don't... I mean, assuming you don't have anything to hide, just, like, say whatever is true and don't say... Like, you know, sometimes they might ask you for your opinion on things. Like... if you don't have some sort of strong opinion, like you don't need to make up an opinion or, because that's where you might slip up and say something wrong that you don't even believe because you're like kind of making it up on the spot. But if you, I guess if they say, what's your opinion on this? You could literally not have an opinion, right?
This is it. It's really important.
As long as it doesn't seem like you're hiding anything.
That's exactly like the, not necessarily the advice my dad's given me, but I'm very conscious of that when I go to Tunisia and stuff. And because I actually don't pay attention to politics, probably on purpose, because I don't want to be seen as supporting a side, whether that's, you know, online, offline, in person. Yeah. Someone asked me a question about this, I don't really know and I don't really care. I just want to live in, you know what I mean, politics doesn't concern me and neither does this.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And I think it's safer going that way a lot of the time because we live in the age of, everybody must know their opinion, like allegiances, and must announce their opinions, and everybody needs to know what I think. But safer not to think sometimes.
Yeah. Okay, so I guess continuing from last episode, where am I? Damn, bro, I'm in all kinds of things on this Mac, trying to get used to this new thing. Oh, here I am. Okay. Wow. Okay, so we had an email, right? So Sister said, "Salaam alaikum wa rahmatullah. I was listening to my most recent episode with Musa Adnan, episode 130, and there was a short discussion on the topic of Orientalism and representation. It was quite interesting, mashallah. I'd like to know if an entire episode could be dedicated to that topic and the ideas and books that were briefed on in the 130th episode. Maybe perhaps elaborate on those points." So I do not remember, like, in terms of books, I remember we were talking about a few books, like I think Musa mentioned like books of tafsir and stuff, but I don't remember books anything to do with the Orientalism.
Maybe we were talking about the access of viewing our history, weren't we? We're talking about viewing our history and viewing our cultures, etc., through different lenses.
Yeah.
And often we exclusively look at the English speaking world's lens of our own history, and we fail to go the other way around. And there's only a few books that have been translated, like the one I kept mentioning about, like, Ibn Fadlan, for example.
History, yeah.
Yeah, going, oh, this is actually just a translation of an Arab perspective or a translation of a perspective. Although I do think, just as a side point, there needs to be more effort into translating more of those books. You know, I think there's a lot of work going on, I can see, evidently so. A lot of religious books are being translated, and, you know, they're on my shelf right now from our, you know, tradition. But as time goes on, I think more people, they'll spread that a bit more, won't they?
Mm-hmm. I think there's a lot of work being done. I'm always hearing of or seeing things like maybe on Facebook and stuff, like new books coming out. I know Musa Ferber. He's, as far as I know, he's a scholar. He's based in Malaysia. I think he's a convert to Islam, and he's churning them out. From what I see, like, he churns out mostly, I think it's translations of books. I think he's done quite a lot of fiqhi books. I think also at least one of Ibn al-Qayyim's books. So, yani, some good stuff. Definitely, you see a lot coming out. You also see, like, the tafsir of Sa'di. That's come out. Like, that's quite a lot of work, isn't it, to translate the tafsir. And that is a tafsir which, you know, the other tafsir, yeah, like, what do we have? I don't even know, actually. You know, tafsir in English, what are the ones that are out there? Because a lot of them are, the ones that come to mind are actually translations, not tafsir.
Oh, you mean, like, so the original tafsir is in English as opposed to a translation of an Arabic work?
Even a translation. What translation of tafsir? What are you aware of? That
I thought there was just mainly Ibn Kathir's tafsir.
Oh yeah, that's true. That's in English. Yes.
Other than that, I'm not.
So that's
aware.
A big one.
Yeah,
that's a big one for sure. And that was done a while ago, I think, wasn't it? I remember. Wow, this must have been at least 10 Ramadans ago. I remember sitting with friends trying to go through that in Ramadan, and it was tricky, bro. It was like very detailed sometimes, like the detailed points, and then the fact that it's in English, not in the original Arabic, made it, you know, not the English I'm used to, kind of thing.
I was sent this as well.
You got Sa'di, yeah.
But this is part 28, 29, and 30, so I don't know how many parts there are.
No, I think that's Juz.
Oh, is it? I thought. Oh, do you think? Oh, is that what it is?
Yeah. I remember Musa was saying on that episode that there are 10 volumes. That tafsir is 10 volumes. But in Arabic, it's one or two volumes. So it kind of balloons when it comes to English.
Yeah.
How was the translation?
Do you know what? I forgot that I even had this. I just looked down to look what books were next to me because I've got a bookshelf.
Yeah.
And I just completely forgot. I think a brother sent me this quite a while ago, so it's embarrassing if he ever listens to this episode. And I'm like, oh, I have not read it yet.
But that is a good gift, I would guess.
Absolutely.
Because I know that tafsir from Arabic, and I know it's one of the shorter, concise kind of ones, which kind of just gives you the gist of what the ayah is about in without going too deep, you know what I mean?
Yeah, actually, this is really good. I'm actually going to look into this because I have been trying to read a bit more. Like we mentioned last episode. But as far as other stuff, like I mentioned about these books, like I bought This recently was just Blood and Faith about the Moriscos or the Muslims in Spain. Just to answer basically the listener's question in relation to sort of getting that Arab Muslim perspective. I haven't read this yet, but when I posted it online, a lot of Muslim brothers got in touch with me and they were like, "Oh, it's really impactful. Like, it made them cry. It was so." But it just
Wow.
showed that it was a double. It showed two perspectives. It wasn't like a, yes, the Christians won and we're heroes. Apparently, it does show the sides quite well. And
Also,
then
it's
the
not
other
written by a
one,
Muslim.
no, I think it's written by, oh, I don't know. Matthew Carr, it says on the front.
Right,
I
okay.
assume he's not Muslim, but maybe the sources that he's obviously using are going to go back to Muslims.
But you know
One
what, bro? Like,
more.
it's very good how much is coming out in English and probably in other languages, of course, as well. Like, I don't know, Russian, Turkish, Bahasa, whatever, right? But I really don't think there's a alternative to Arabic. Like, there
No,
really,
of
really
course.
isn't. And I don't think that Arabic has got harder to learn. I think that we've got less
Lazier.
bothered or whatever it is, but less emphasis on it. And I think no matter how many translated works or works written in originally in English come out, you know, I hope that doesn't take away from the emphasis on actually learning Arabic, you know, because you literally, bro, it'll be 200 years and we still wouldn't have translated all those. And especially
Although,
when you translate, you lose some of the meaning as well.
I think we do look at it as a bit of a bubble and an exclusivity deal where we're like, we need to translate it for the Muslims. We need to, translate it for the Muslims in England. When actually, something like this has probably, this is The Travels of Ibn Battuta, translated obviously from his writings. But this is like a bestseller at some point, I think. In that kind of field, in the history field and stuff. Obviously, everyone knows what Ibn Battuta is. A lot of people, a lot of non-Muslims would come across it. And I'm not saying this is like a dawah book, However, it could be a spark of intrigue, Although there are some, I've seen a bit of a summary of some aspects of it, and I'm like, oh, I don't know. I need to see this in context. I need to read these parts in context about like how many people he married and, just leaving kids all over the world. I was just like, oh, that's a bit weird, but I need to read that in context. And I think that is what's lost when it is not coming from a Muslim, I'd like to see those historical figures through a Muslim writing that kind of that lens, so that I then know maybe why they did certain things of that time. However, an English or a non-Muslim writer is just going to say, yeah, this is what these Muslims did back then. They married 100 women and they left kids all over the place, and that was just normal. But yeah, as far as, like I mentioned before we recorded, the main sort of book on Orientalism by Edward Said, despite referencing it so much at uni, I never actually read it. I would get some quotes here and there, and I was like, okay, put that in. That's a good quote. Yeah, let me use that. I'll use my point. But to actually read it cover to cover, never done it.
What about the
Never
topic
done.
of representation, right? It's something that I hear pop up from, those what would you call them? That kind of what they call them? SJW, that's it. From the SJW types. That's where I see it pop up, right? And it's like a whole, it's obviously kind of gone mainstream. And it's something I really noticed a lot when I went to the UK this time, because, and even my mum told me she noticed it, that on TV, for example, the ads, they all have to have like non-white people in them. Like a lot of, like all the ads pretty much, right? There's no more ads that just have white people in. And I was actually discussing it like with my mum and stuff, and I was, I don't know if this is controversial or not, but I was thinking, look, if I was English and white and I'm looking at t on TV, like, how do I say it? I would expect, and I think what makes sense is that the people on TV should represent, using the word represent, it should represent the population. Surely that would be normal, right? Which means maybe 5 in 100 people would be. Not five, let's say 10. 10 in 100 people would not be white. But we've got to remember that the UK is majority white country. So if I was English and white, and I started seeing like 50% of people on TV not being white, I would feel like, I don't know, I don't know what I would feel like, but I could understand if someone felt like, well, what's going on? Like, this is, you know, quote unquote, our country, and like, why are we not on our own TV channels and our own ads? And you know what I mean? So I would really understand that, I think. And I always try and put myself in the shoes of, okay, I'm Algerian. I feel like I'm an Algerian citizen, and I'm part of Algeria. Let's say I'm in Algeria, and then I'm watching TV, and literally 20, 30, 40% of the ads have Chinese people. Let's say, because quite a lot of Chinese people in Algeria, like maybe it's the second or third biggest minority group or immigrant group. Yeah. Chinese. How would I feel? I'll feel like that's kind of wrong. Like that's, again, it's not representative of the thing, because Algerians would be, is like 98% of Algerian population. You get it? So I do agree that you should be truly representative, meaning don't like only have white people, when no, it's true, there is a 10% of the population that are not white, you know, so you shouldn't give a false impression.
Yeah, although I don't think that, you know, I must preface by saying that most of the time I don't care about representation in the media from my own background. However, I can appreciate people's concern. I think I do see a legitimate thing there. For example, from a historical context, England wouldn't be England without, you know, without having its cake and eating it, in the sense that, you know, using all of these countries, using their resources, using their workforce, using their slave labor even, you know?
Yes.
And then like, look at the Windrush scandal of like, oh yeah, we, you know, you guys were part of our colony and we told you that you were British, but not really, you know, trying to backpedal on all of that. Yeah. Well, no, you can't just build an empire on, you know, people from all colors and all nations and then close the door once your empire is built. You can't lie to people and say that they're British, because I'm reading, I'm reading about the audiobook of Akala's Natives Class, Empire, Ruins of Empire or something like that.
Yeah.
And he talks about it, like, it's a good insight because I've never really delved into that topic. But he talks about how, like, in the Caribbean and in the British colonies, they were taught there that they were British. Like, they were taught, hey, listen, you love the Queen, you wave that flag, you are British. Yeah. And they felt like they were. So when they came to England and they were treated like second-class citizens, they were just like, what the hell? I thought, like, my whole life I thought I was British.
Yes.
Like, what's that about?
Yes.
So I get that and I appreciate that. And if there is the need for representation, I fully appreciate it. I don't think companies, because these adverts that you're seeing, the companies aren't going to care too much about the different. Like, okay, we can't have more than two people of color. We need to have just one because that's going to match. They don't care about, like, you know, we've been behind the camera before. We've been behind those sort of shoots before, and those, you know, any sort of organization or any sort of business trying to run something. Those detailed nitty-gritty conversations about, okay, we need to be really accurately representative, but we can only have this. That doesn't happen. That doesn't happen. Generally, what happens is we get a casting call. Okay, make sure that it's a bit diverse. All right, one person makes a decision. Yeah, we'll have that one, and that one. Do you know what I mean? It's very blasé about how they achieve that.
I was wondering what the conversation was, you know, in the you know, meeting or in the boardroom or whatever, to lead to this, because it's so common, it means that what I would imagine is everyone is like on all these big companies, they're coming, sitting down together, and they're saying, look, the in thing, the trendy thing, the whatever to seem progressive, we need to do this. We need to be more diverse. We need to have more representation, right?
I mean,
so we need to tick that box. And that's why, you know, like part of when I watch it, maybe some people feel like it's, oh yeah, representation. I feel like it's a bit of an insult to representation, because I know it's just a tick box on someone's job. You know what I mean?
Yeah, maybe. I mean, so I don't know about the private sector, but at least like the public sector, then that's where I work.
Yeah.
They're like, my whole side of work is about representation, is about diversity, inclusivity, right? And literally all day, every day, that's just what my work revolves around. And like just today, for example, it was a big meeting of like 20 people that were all trying to figure things out like this. And then the day before that, there was another meeting with loads of other people, all these, you know, high officials and high this and that. And it's like, there's so much money being pumped into it, and there's national conferences about it, and we all have to attend it. So there's so much money being pumped into it that actually, to be honest, I am a bit more inclined to say, actually, it's more than just a tick box now. There are definitely people with power that are trying to change this. It's not just people that are, you know, what we think, which I think for a lot of organizations maybe, that are just like, oh, we need to tick the box so the government can leave us alone so we can say that we're doing this. No, I think there is now people in those organizations that actually do deeply care about it,
yeah,
and are, you know, really trying to push that home. However, when you've initiated this convo, it did make me think of like the latest sort of representation scandal I've seen in the media. If you remember when I said I was reading Dune and I told he's got all these Arabic sort of phrases and stuff.
Okay.
Well, there was an issue of representation when the book came out. Actually, no, there wasn't. Not back when the book came out, because that was 1965, when the film came out. So there was a film that came out recently of that very book.
Hmm.
And I remember TRT, that news channel, they started reporting on how there was no Arab or Muslim actors or anything within the whole movie. And it's a very white savior story. And it kind of is. I mean, I think there's two and four, but the premise of the story is like, you know, a foreign invader, a foreign people, which you could typically say a white people from another planet, which you could say is also another country, have come to the desert planet where the desert savages live, so to speak.
Right.
And the desert savages see one of the, you know, the so-called prince of this people, these, as like their savior, as like their Mehdi, actually. They even refer to the word Mehdi. And he's going to lead them on this great crusade, and he's going to save them from the, and he's going to transform them. So, yeah, you can see the themes there.
Yeah.
But then, obviously, when you watch the film, it's like, yeah, there aren't no Arabs here. In fact, all the people that play the so-called desert people that were meant to be based on Muslims and Arabs, I know very much that, at least from the actors I recognize, they're not that ethnicity whatsoever.
Yeah.
You know, there's some black actors, which, you know, that can go either way, really. But there's definitely, like, I think one of them is Mexican, one of them is mixed race, but certainly there isn't any Arabs or whatever. There might be extras that were, but you're never going to know their names. So yeah, I saw people commenting, like, there was some either Arab or Muslim sort of, you know, personalities online that were saying, oh, this is, you know, this is always happening and this and that. You know, if you want to celebrate our stories and our culture, then listen to our stories and our culture. Don't take it from these other people. One example, which, sorry to keep going on, but I remember before, you know, Aladdin came out a few years ago, probably years ago now. They did like a live action thing of Aladdin, Disney did. And they hired, the main guy who played it is a Coptic Arab, so Christian Arab.
Yeah.
He famously came out and said after he did that film, despite it being like a blockbuster, you know, he's with Will Smith and I don't know who the other actress is, but you know, it's a big film. He couldn't get any parts after that film, despite the fact that he was like, you know, he made it, so to speak. He's a lead in a Disney film.
Oh, how come?
In the live action version of that. He said that that's it. Hollywood doesn't hire Arabs unless they're, you know, they only hired Arabs specifically for that particular role because it was Aladdin. Like, you can't get away with hiring. You know what I mean? Like, however.
So he can play the role of an Arab in a film, but he can't play a neutral role if
you
like.
Yeah, he can't play, you know, he can't play the lead of, you know, Matrix or whatever. I don't know, something like that. Like, he couldn't get any roles afterwards. Right. And this came off the back of it. But it does remind me, like, years and years ago, I remember a film, Prince of Persia, that's based on that video game, isn't it? And I keep seeing it on
thick the list game. Of, like, films. Bro, thick game.
But Disney did a similar thing. Disney did a movie on Prince of Persia, and the main actor was Jake Gyllenhaal, who played the Prince of Persia. And people are like, well, what the hell? Like, he's not Persian. He's not even near the Middle East. He's obviously an American actor. So why couldn't they just get somebody from that heritage? So people do get hinged and bent, you know, bent out of shape on this sort of issue.
Yes, yes.
And I think it's because we are, the West is moving, you know, as much as it, there's going to be, in the past, there's going to be this nationalistic and this, you know, white pride, so to speak, and whatever you want to call it. Slowly the demographics are changing and you can't have your cake and eat it. You can't build your empire on the backs of other people and then cut them off from being participants of your society. Whether we like it or not, the West, it will be more diverse than everywhere else. You know, like you said about Algeria, for example, of course, the minority is going to be Chinese, but there's a reason for that. It's not just out of the blue. That's because of the, you know, economic situation and the business opportunities that are going on there. However, majority of Algeria is going to be Arabs and Berber, right? And actually, at face value, you wouldn't even know the difference unless they spoke. or they told you what their heritage is. But you look, you know, you go to London or you go anywhere else in the UK or America, you're just seeing the entire rainbow of people. And that is going to be the country. That is going to be the norm. Have you ever seen those studies they did on like the future of human beings and how color might even disappear because, you know, because of globalization, everybody living everywhere, you know, everybody's basically going to be mixed race to such an extent that actually most people are going to be probably, I don't know, probably my shade of brown, so to speak, because of, you know, the averaging of.
I mean, maybe even in the Akala book, he'll talk about that, but even the concept of race is a bit questionable, right? Like, what does mixed race even mean? Like, I think we're all mixed race. Like, just because you have white skin, it doesn't mean you're not mixed race, right? There are many white. I mean, this is the thing. Like, I think, as far as I understand, ethnicity is an actual objective scientific thing where you can trace genes, you know? But race is literally a social thing, like a social construct, if you like. So if you say, I'm white English, like, that's not enough. Like, you could be part, you know, kind of Southern Mediterranean, right? Mm. And mixed with part, you know, like Scandinavian, for example, yeah? Mm. You could say those are two different races, yeah? But now we're summarizing it as white. Mm.
There's a lot of overlap and there's a lot of differences even on a small level. Like, you know, within a... Like, look at us, for example, bro. Like, Tunisia and Algeria, there's just one border, right?
Yeah.
But I will still feel like I'm different biologically than an Algerian. And I don't know why that is the case. But obviously, the further apart you are, the more biology plays into it. But actually, within the same country, you've got divisions. Within the same neighborhoods, you've got divisions. Like, divisions always exist.
But I was going to say, bro, like, even Algeria, if you look on TV in Algeria or just go to Algeria, you're going to see a lot of diversity, right? Mm. They're all like Arab or Berber, like you're saying, but there's actually every single shade. If you want to talk about colors of skin, there's every single shade.
Yeah.
You know, and it actually, from what I remember, Yanni, it is represented because it's just kind of natural that, you know, oh, we need this guy to do this ad or we need this actor. And some of them are, you know, darker, some are lighter, and it's just kind of like whatever, you know, rather than it being a thing. Obviously, I'm not saying there's no like colorism or whatever, but I'm saying there is that kind of diversity, you know, in what people look like. But you know what you were saying about what was the first Dune, for example, yeah?
Yeah.
Do you think those actors actually should have been like of Arab origin that represent those that play the roles of those people?
It goes back to, I mean, it's based on a book, so it's difficult. So the book itself, the story, unless you're going to change the story, the book very much focused on an external people or an external, it was actually, they were leaders. So they were a family of leaders, you know what I mean? Like a royal family, so to speak, from another planet, came over to this planet and ruled the natives. The whole premise of the book was like these natives were already being ruled by a corrupt and an oppressive regime of outsiders. They got replaced by another group of outsiders. However, these group of outsiders were meant to be better than the last. And actually, that's where the friction. The old rulers and the new rulers are fighting over this. A bit like the world, really. Imagine it's basically like
American invasion of Iraq.
Yeah, it's like imagine America is funding the Afghanis to fight the Russians. It's kind of like that, in a way.
Yes,
you know. And are the Americans going to be our new oppressors? In fact, the beginning of the movie, there's a monologue where one of the natives is basically saying, "Oh, I wonder who our new oppressors will be," you know. And that's when it cuts to the new sort of leaders coming. Should they have been Arab? Maybe the ones that played the natives.
Yeah.
Maybe they should have been. However, they want an all-star cast, and it very much is an all-star cast in that. Is there an all-star cast of Arab actors? You can name maybe two.
Not in Hollywood.
Well, at least in the British world. And, you know, like, I know Riz Ahmed is very famous. He's cut through a lot
but
of
he's
that.
He's not Arab.
No, I'm talking about Muslim. Okay, I'm talking about Muslim in this sense, because it was based on a lot of Islamic themes.
But so now is it about religion or is it about...
It's the crossover, isn't it? It's the crossover. It's about what what is it, what part of representation are you trying to achieve?
Yeah.
And like, it goes back to Aladdin, I don't know, Aladdin, I don't know. Is Aladdin a Muslim? Who wrote that story? Mm. Where is it based on? 99, you know, what is it, Arabian Nights?
I thought it was Chinese.
There you go. Like, what is it?
I thought the original you know? Story was about a Chinese guy.
The Disneyfication of it definitely made it feel like it was Arab.
Yes.
But then again, there's a lot of Indian thing. Like, it's basically like the ultimate Orientalist movie.
Yeah, really, it is.
You know, even when I saw a trailer for that film. I've never seen the film, but when I saw a trailer for it, I thought it was a Bollywood movie. There was lots of Bollywood stuff going on. But then at the same time, like, if I remember in the cartoon, the princess has like a tiger, and that's very Bollywood as well, or very like, I mean, I don't know about tigers in the Arab world, but definitely associate tigers with India. So it's like, what
and
we
then his
here?
Name's like Arab, and then they've got like those, well, the palaces, I'm trying to think of the old Disney one. The palaces are actually Mughal style, right? The buildings from India. So it seems like it should be Indian actually.
Yeah, that's what I'm getting the vibe, but I'm trying to think. I mean, even the dress code, I'm leaning more towards. So what is it that is giving me the impression that it's Arab? I mean, the concept of a genie is definitely Arab, because it comes from the jinn sort of thing.
Maybe, but I'm sure all cultures have something they call,
so
like,
here we go, adapted from 1001 Nights. And 1001 Nights is a collection of Middle Eastern folk tales.
Persian,
called in Arabic. Maybe it is. Look, it's obviously in its Western.
It's messed up.
It's messed up because it dawned in the age of pure Orientalism.
Yes,
you know?
Exactly.
Like, oh, look at these Easterners. Let's just amalgamate everything together and call it Aladdin, and that's it.
Yeah.
So that's why I think there was a bit of a mess when it came to adapting it for the big screen in the modern day. But you know, Hollywood is trying to do that. Oh, let's get an Arab actor. Let's get an Arab actress. But I even remember back then, I think one of my sisters was like, oh, they're making an Aladdin thing. And she goes, oh, why is this actress playing the princess? And I was like, I don't know who the actress is. What's the deal? And I think I remember them saying, oh, she's not Arab and she's not this. She's, I don't know, whatever she was.
Hmm.
And I was like, oh, fair enough. But that's happened a lot, bro. And that's always happened. Like, I remember there was a Japanese anime, Ghost in a Shell was adapted for the big screen some years ago. And, you know, to be honest, Japanese anime is quite, you know, you can interpret it however you want. It's a drawing, isn't it? But, yeah, it was the actress was obviously a famous American actress or whatever, playing a Japanese. The main character is meant to be Japanese. It's all meant to be set in Japan. So people are like, why the hell? Like, I remember seeing the rage of that at the same time.
Yes.
But it is changing. It is changing. There's another one. There's a new adaptation of another anime called Cowboy Bebop. Some people might know about that. Netflix are creating it. I saw the trailer, and they're hiring an Asian actor to play the main character.
Mm.
So there is, you know, in the underbelly of it all, there is people moving towards that. Should it be the case? I think the best part wins, so to speak. However, if it's a story, and this reminds me of another film, and I know I'm talking about films a lot, but if it's a story very much focused on a particular people and a particular culture, then it should be. And it reminds me of a poster that I saw for like a film about the Great Wall of China. And it was called The Great Wall, I think. And if you look it up, I mean, I'm going to bring it up only because it's hilarious. I don't know what the film is. Let me bring it up because people are going to laugh with me. Here we go. Look at this film. Can I share screen?
Okay, I'm
sorry. Share screen. Oh, come on, guys. Go for it.
Make sure you enable the audio.
Oh, I'm not going to show the trailer. I just want to show the picture.
Oh, okay, picture, okay.
Oh God,
the Great Wall.
The Great Wall. So can you see?
Okay, I see.
Oh, why won't it open up?
No, you know what?
Okay. I'm going to zoom in like that.
Yes.
Can you see what's going
on
here?
They're all Asian looking, except.
And then you've got Matt Damon with a very sort of Asian sort of hairstyle, so to speak, like matching his counterparts.
Yes.
Here's another one. And it's like, I don't know what the story is. I don't know if he's meant to be from somewhere else.
Yeah.
And he's come over. However, I remember the flame war about it online where people were like, what the hell is Matt Damon doing playing the main character of a film like this?
Yeah.
You know? And it is funny to look at. It is funny to look at sometimes. It's just like, what the hell is going on?
It does look funny, Wallah.
It does look, honestly.
This is what I'm thinking. I don't really have a strong opinion on this, but I think like the example you're giving of this or the or Ghost in a Shell, I think it makes sense that the actors are from that place.
Mm.
Yeah. What's this supposed to, Dragon Ball
this
Z.
This came out years ago. This came out years ago. And everyone knows Dragon Ball, but they made a live action one absolutely years ago. And it was dreadful.
Yeah.
But once again, you know, it was an all-white cast. Apart from one character.
Are any of these famous? They're not, right?
I don't really know them.
Yeah,
I don't really know them. Yeah. But anyway.
Yeah, so, like, you know where it makes sense? Like, if I was the director, I guess I would want that, wouldn't I? I would want it to make sense in terms of it's Ghost in the Shell, it's Japanese, it's set in Japan. So all the actors should be Japanese looking. That would make the most sense, right?
Yeah.
The
yeah.
only place I can understand if they didn't do that is if they're like, okay, we need an A-list actor or actress, yeah? We need an A-list one, and none of the A-list ones from that part of the world, so we got to throw this guy in, right? However, I think you could still work around that, and you could make an A-lister, right? Assuming, you know, it's even a good idea to make films, right? But just putting that aside, right? So I understand that. But you know something like where it's a bit more ambiguous, like Dune? Because Dune, it was like a book, and it wasn't written anywhere that it was about a certain people. You know, maybe I'm not that bothered. Overall, I've got to say, if something is Hollywood and they're making up a story, it's a made-up story, and it's supposed to be about Arabs and they don't have Arab actors, I don't think I care, to be honest. What I think does matter, and this is what I think the problem with the conversation around representation is, people are they feel good about token things. Right. So we throw a few actors from this place in there, people chill. Yeah. But no, what I would like to see more is if the story itself is from a certain place in the world, let the producer or the director be from that place and kind of represent the story properly. Right. Yeah. Rather than what you get in Hollywood is the film's based in Pakistan and the actors are speaking to each other in Arabic. You know, this kind of rubbish. So what I would... rather than just the face being from that place, I'd rather the power and the actual storytelling is in the hands of people who know the culture from which the story originates. That's what I would be more like cool about. Going back to the ads, for example, I would say the same about the ads. I could not really care less what kind of people are in the ads. What I would care about is what you were talking about in terms of, for example, job opportunities not being discriminatory. Or for example, if I'm living in an area where does in London, you know, there are areas with lots, for example, of black people, I think it does make sense for the police, because of the history, the police to be black. Because this matters. This, I feel like it matters. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
but,
absolutely.
But you know, like token stuff, like just putting faces on an ad for 10 seconds, I feel like that, it just calms the masses in order to not then make the vital deep changes that you were talking about, you know?
No one wants to be cancelled. But you know what? This is my biggest pet peeve, is about the relegation of all this stuff towards entertainment and music. So I went to a Black History. I went to a Black History event in a local town. It was the first Black History event they've ever done, right? And it was obviously about Black History. But all of the people that they had speaking, or performing, should I say, it was just music. It was like, oh, this is music from my place. This is where I come from, and this is the music we play here. It's an instrument I'm playing. And then there was some poetry as well. And the poetry, I appreciate it a bit more. But obviously, I went for work. I didn't go, obviously, to go to a concert or whatever, but that was part of the thing that was there. Yeah. I just realized what I said. I was like, oh, this... Anyway, but yeah, I was just like, why is it every time like these deep and rich cultures are getting sidelined just to this tiny aspect of what they bring to the table, which is music and food, right? And it's always that. And I hate that, because it just relegates, that's what I get irked about. It relegates this the power of these cultures and what they brought to the table, the knowledge and the element, the benefit, the technology, everything. It's like, forget all about that. Let's talk about what we like, which is your music and your food. And when I say we, I'm talking about like the West, you know, the West love the food of the foreigners and they love the music of the foreigners, right? So that's what we're going to talk about. And that's what we're going to focus on, the stuff that we like. Not the stuff that challenges the status quo, not the stuff that, oh, look at this history. Look at, you know, we look what we invented back then and look what you stole from us, you know, that kind of stuff, those uncomfortable conversations. But it won't be had. So I think some, obviously there is going to be some people that champion that, and there's going to be some of Black History organizations that champion telling those stories and explaining that to people. But until it's ingrained, because one of the messages, the key messages was like, that one of the speakers had was like, it's not Black history, it's human history, and it should be taught in schools, you know? So you shouldn't relegate it to just Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, civil rights, because that is what taught in schools. You talk about everything. But there's only a certain amount of hours in a lesson, isn't there? And they got to cover all of Henry VIII's wives, all of the Tudors and all the battles of Hastings and whatever.
Yeah, I mean, genuinely, you know, like, especially if we live in a big city, it's easily justified to teach like a broader history than just British or Western European history, you know?
Yeah.
It does make sense. And I think it would have better outcomes for a lot of things, you know, not just... You know, not just like stuff like decreased racism, but I just think like people who are more aware of beyond stuff beyond their culture, they're just like better off, you know what I mean?
But I think until it's normal for countries, every country, to teach its kids about the mistakes of its own country, then you're never going to change anything. Like, I don't think that now that I'm reading this book and seeing the, you know, seeing the, because obviously I haven't taken a huge interest in it before because I'm not from that background, so I've been very interested in my own background, but now that I'm delving into other backgrounds and stuff, it's like, wow, it was dreadful, you know, like it came across part of the book where it's talking about like the massacres that were committed in Haiti. It was literally like Holocaust, bro. Like when they realized that all these slaves were just going to rebel and keep rebelling, they were like, right, the only way that we can quell this, and this was like a joint operation between England and France, if I'm remembering correctly, the only way that we can quell this is by literally going to Haiti and killing every single person indiscriminately and then replacing the whole population with new slaves that we'll bring from Africa. So that was the solution to the problem. It was like merchandise, like burning all your merchandise and just replacing it because all this merchandise is infected. And they fought them off, bro. They fought them off. But bro, I remember like reading part of it was like, they trained all these dogs from God knows where, these rabid dogs, and just let them loose into the you know, the population just to eat them all. They trained these dogs just to eat humans.
Wow.
And just, you know, women, children, whatever. It was like, they were just merchandise, bro. These rebellious merchandise. We need to get rid of all of them and bring back fresh merchandise.
Yeah.
And that was how people, human beings were seen. So like when you read about the history and you read about that pain, it's like, hey, representation matters to you and you have every right to be upset because all you can think about is the blood that has been spilt. And that's why when you go back to what you said at the start about, oh, you know, some people, some British or white British people might look at this advert and be like, oh, I don't know why my situation's changing, whatever. I think it's important to appreciate the historical context of why we are where we are today. Because for that person, for that, I don't know where you want to call it, Black individual, whatever, with that kind of history and the legacy behind them, that's a lived experience to them. Like, they're like, bro, like, my ancestors were massacred and hunted and whatever to build this country. Of course I've got a right to take what's mine in terms of representation, to be here, to be part of it, right? And screw you if you don't care, or screw you if you don't care about that. And you, because some people will say, oh, I didn't do that, you know, oh, my ancestors might, but that's got nothing to do with me. It doesn't really matter. It happened, you know, it happened. And the benefits that you're having in this country of, you know, economic stability, wealth, or whatever it is, or just all of this was built on the backs of others. And it's happening today, but they're trying to stop people from doing that today. Like, look at China, for example. I'm not saying what China's doing is correct. However, when all these countries try and take shortcuts to reach the heights of what the Western world has, whether that's cutting corners with climate or child labor, whatever, the West's like, no, you're not allowed to do that. You're not allowed to do that and that and that. forgetting that they did it in the past. And I think it's just a convenient thing to say to them, don't do that, because they don't want them catching up. Yeah, they don't really care. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? But bro, like reading about how the Western world, and specifically England, just the oppression, just to get to where they're at today, the oppression. So for them to sit on their high horse now and say, you know, anyway, history is important, bro. That's ultimately what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
Learning about it is important.
It's true. It's just, you know what someone told me, which I thought was, you know, a good way of saying it. Whenever there's a big news event, look elsewhere and see what what spotlight that event is taking away from something else happening.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And it's kind of like, kind of linked to what you're saying. Like when they just slap, you know, people in ads or whatever it is, like what is actually, you know, under the iceberg, which is all the history and all of that.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, the companies and private companies, bro, they don't want to be cancelled. That's the main thing. They don't want to be the next trending thing on Twitter because they...
Yeah, yeah. Probably, they just sit down, yeah. They're like, look, there's a guy, his whole full-time job, sad job, unfortunately. He just does, like, risk assessments all day, yeah. And one of the risks is we're going to get cancelled, so we need to, like, do this.
Yeah.
So it doesn't feel very genuine, but, yeah. You know, like, from the point of view of, like, France and Algeria, for example, yeah?
Yeah. Good example.
Obviously, I don't live in France, okay, but as an Algerian, I would say I do not want an apology from the president. I don't want none of that. Yeah, I don't even care if you're sorry. Yeah, you're not sorry. You can't change anything. Yeah, but I would say stop stealing from us today because you're stealing from us today. Stop playing with our internal politics today because you're doing that today. Yeah. Return Yanni our money back. Yeah, and gold and whatever you talk. And halas, leave us alone. I don't want apology. I don't want, you know, Algerians to be in your ads or anything like that. You know, that's like, that would be the real change, if you like, not a token thing. That's what I would say. And some people, they want apology. Yanni, I wouldn't even believe it if they apologize, you know. Yeah. Like, let them do, and if they want to do some things that are a little bit more surface level but significant, I would say stop naming your number one main airport in your country after a murderer and a colonizer, you know, Charles de Gaulle. Stop that. Remove that. Change it to something else, you know. Yeah. These are things that they're a bit more symbolic, but they actually have some meaning behind them.
Well, this is what people went to. This is what people have been targeting who are obviously trying to change the status quo. Like, remember the Black Lives Matter protests and all the statues that they were pulling down?
Yes.
And it's still happening, obviously, across the world. It was these symbols of that,
I think that makes they were sense, celebrating. Bro. I think that makes sense to change, because that's some level of significant way of saying we're actually ashamed of that. Like, I know you didn't do it yourself. I'm not going to blame you. You didn't do it. Maybe even your parents didn't do it. Maybe your great-grandparents were involved somehow. You don't have to be sorry because you didn't do it. But come on, don't leave these things and be proud of these things.
Yeah, it's one thing writing about them in the history books, and that's, you know, that's history, as long as history is objective, ideally. But like putting a statue and celebrating this individual.
Yeah, and it being in a like very prominent thing. Like, I don't mind if you had a statue of some criminal guy, put it in your museum for the sake of history. No problem. Don't put it on like the number one street in the capital city.
Yeah.
You know, that's what I would say. And I'm sure Muslim countries have some examples of similar things. And I would apply the same to that.
This is it. I wanted to say, actually, just quickly, I don't want Muslims to sleepwalk into this idea that because Islam is perfect, that we're perfect. Historically, we Muslims, obviously, have committed atrocities as well, you know, and we have to be conscious of that, because what happens is that sometimes get mixed up in dawah, and people that you're giving dawah to will bring that back. And actually, I came across it in the book itself, where he was talking about Muslims, he's talking about the North African slave trade and all this other stuff. And it's like, I read that and I was accepting that and I internalized that and I was like, yeah, this is part of our history, you know, and some of the bad things that Muslims have done, because right now this second, there's Muslims creating atrocities around the world. Right? Muslim leaders, for example, that are shooting and murdering their people, whatever it is. And 1,000 years from now, if we're all still around, they're going to look history, back. Yeah, that'll be Muslim history once again. There'll be 1,000 years from now, there'll be a Muslim trying to give dawah to a non-Muslim. And they'll say, yeah, but back in 2021, those Muslims, I remember that back then. I've read about it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So we have to be conscious of that, and we have to obviously separate Islam from Muslims in that sense. Also, we need to learn about our history so we don't make those mistakes again. So we're conscious, because sometimes it's not even just you'd like to think that back in history people were closer to the deen, and because of that, some people actually use the deen in malignant ways to justify atrocities. Right? You know, there is clear writings, subhanAllah, from Muslims somehow using the deen, and it was in history books, to justify like why. And obviously, I don't agree with this at all, but why black people are inferior to Arabs? Can you imagine? Like, they were using something in that time. They were people of knowledge at that time that wrote in their books that kind of thing. And it's just like, well, we need to be aware that this exists, and we need to be aware of the mistakes that some of our predecessors made, so we don't start sleepwalking into this mess that the West have got themselves into.
I was listening to watching a short video, and Muhammad Hijab was... He was talking, I think it was about a democracy, but in general, he was saying, look, Muslims, we don't have the perfect history. Yeah, we don't have a perfect track record. But what you will see is the overall trend is positive. Yeah, the overall trend, and especially when people were kind of trying to live by the principles of Islam, things were good, things were positive. You know, he was talking about the great... kind of golden age in Andalusia. He said a lot of the positive things that came out of that, they were not even Muslim, right? The people that did whatever discoveries and whatever, they were not Muslim, but they were in an environment that was created because of Islamic principles. You know what I mean? Like Jews could not flourish in Western Europe, but Jews could flourish in like Spain or whatever. It's Muslim Spain, right? So he was saying that if you take our overall history, you get rid of those little like 10-year periods, and you just look over like 100-year period, you'll just find generally good things, especially when Islam was being followed. And also, he says, and this I thought was quite important as well, is that, you know, these great, you know, whatever you want to call them, Muslim scientists, like al-Khawarizmi or whatever, Ibn al-Haytham, he said, what you'll find if you look at their biographies and stuff is that they were inspired by Islam. It wasn't that they were just people of science and they happened to be Muslim. It's that, no, their Islam led them to become scientists, if you like. And that's like an important kind of link to make, instead of just assuming for da'wah purposes that, oh yeah, Muslims did all this, therefore Islam is good. That's an assumption. But when we look deep, we actually do find that Islam led them to become those positive contributors, you know?
And it shows you the closer that we as individuals and societies as well are to Islam, the better, obviously. The further away we are, it makes us no different to any other debased human being that's morally corrupt in the world, that's committing crimes, or committing atrocities. You know, the further away you are from the deen, the more facade that you've got within you, the more crimes you're going to commit, the more oppression you're going to be capable of doing.
And it's like, I think it was Umar bin Khattab, he was talking about like in terms of battle and stuff. He's like, look, if we have more sins than the enemy, why would we win? He's so like, it's all to do with that. You know, it's not to do with like technology, weapons, numbers. It's literally like taqwa and amount of sins and amount of hasanat and tawheed and shirk. And this is what wins battles. So, and even you could argue that having kind of, you know, coming up, having these breakthroughs, right, like scientific breakthroughs, it only happens with a certain level of clarity of mind. And clarity of mind is linked to actual tawheed and stuff, right? Because like like Allah says, like the munafiqeen, la yafqahoon, they don't understand. So I think, I remember asking a sheikh about this, and he didn't disagree, I'll put it like that. I don't remember exactly if he was like, yeah, that's true, definitely. But he didn't say it was wrong. Like, so there is that clarity and foresight you get. And that's from Allah. Like you could say it's like nur from Allah, that you can not just see guidance in terms of the haram and halal, but also in terms of like discoveries and stuff, right? Okay, this was actually turned out to be one question, and it was a whole episode on it. So... inshallah, that was satisfying, even though I don't know if we're the most experienced in the area, but, you know, sometimes it's just...
No, good. Funnily enough, you know, that is my field of work, and I've been doing that since March. I've realized, you know, the difficulty is representing Muslims in a space where you have to accept everything else as well. You know, that is the difficulty, is like, how much of yourself can you keep in a society that wants to be truly representative? Mm. To represent the Muslim, we need to also represent the, you know, whatever.
And this is the ABC, this is a problem, EMG. Perhaps, bro, is that, you know, like, when it comes to representation, yeah, races, right, race or ethnicities, they're all equal. There's no saying one is better than the other, right?
Yeah.
But when it comes to ideas, values, religions, you can say that.
Yeah.
You can judge it. And so that's where it gets tricky, because the kind of mainstream culture in the UK, for example, they are putting them all in the same kind of boat in terms of, yeah, we want to be diverse in everything, in ethnicities, in religions, in sexual orientations. All of it is kind of the same thing, and we want to be equal in all of it. And so that's where it gets tricky, I guess, for people in your position.
You know, I was going to show another poster, but I'd rather not. But there was this Amazon show, I think. It came out maybe in September. I saw a trailer of it. Not that I wanted to. But it's called, like, Everybody's Talking About Jamie. And I think it's, I don't know, the poster's got a man or boy, and he's wearing loads of makeup, and he's like, yeah, whatever. But then the one of the second characters in the trailer, at least, or in the poster as well, I was going to show, is a hijabi Muslima, right? And it's let's just throw the representation in there. Let's represent everybody. And everybody loves everybody, and let's all hold hands and sing Kumbaya. You know? And that is the dilution, you know, I'm afraid, and it is difficult.
I find it hard to believe that's not on purpose.
Here's another one,
and in a bad way.
Another one, at least at work, and I don't want to talk about this one too much, because I'm still trying to navigate myself with it. But it's like, they're doing an Islamophobia awareness thing for the first time I've ever come across it, and they're like, "Yo, do you want to take part?" And I was like, "Yeah, absolutely, that's awesome," you know. And then. I think I might be hosting it or something, which was news to me. So if I'm hosting something, I'd like to be part of, like, who we're bringing on, who's talking, whatever, right?
Yeah.
And then I had a look at the sort of resume of who's coming on, and I was like, oh, there's this, I'm not even going to name him because people start Googling him. It was like, oh, there's this particular imam who's coming, and he's like a bit of an influencer or whatever. And I was like, oh, okay. I didn't recognize his name. And then he's got a little like handle. Didn't recognize his handle. And then it said something about, and he wants to talk to everybody about promoting a modern understanding of what Islam is. And I was like, well, I thought it was about Islamophobia, so I'm not comfortable about that. Then I looked him up. He's on Instagram. And he's very much following quite a few people that I follow, but nobody I follow follows him. So that's a red flag. I was like, he's got 7,000 followers, but nobody I know follows him. And he's a bit of an influencer or whatever. And that's like trying to dig deep. And he comes across as super liberal and super this and super that. And like, you know, I check who he's following, and it's like loads of like women influencers and loads of men. And everybody's got blue tech marks. Like, that's basically what he's trying to do. And obviously I came across one of the messages that he was bigging up. And then I realized his surname and all this other stuff. And I realized, I think he's part of the Ahmadiyya sort of thing. And obviously, as far as I know, for the Ahmadiyya community, or the Ahmadiyya belief, sorry, is like, that isn't Islam to me whatsoever. You know, believing in that particular, going to that extent where you're saying the Prophet ﷺ is not the final messenger, and actually there's a new prophet, whatever, you can disagree till the cows come home. But now I'm forced into this space of like talking about Islam or hosting this Islamophobia event, but I can't say, well, who brought this guy on and who is he? Do you know what I mean? And I don't, so it's like, it's hard, because imagine even Muslim representation gets usurped. The mainstream Muslims often don't fill those spaces, but who are the loudest and most vocal, who are trying to get into those spaces from the Muslim sphere, are the minority Muslim groups. You know, why is it that, like, fringe, that Imam Tawhidi guy, whatever his name is, the very radical Shia one who just spurts absolute nonsense, gets on all the TV shows and stuff? Because he's desperate to get that representation on behalf of his small minority of people that think like him, to represent all of Muslims. Same with this guy, desperate for that representation, desperate to get involved, desperate to engage with all these, like, because I was looking on his Instagram, he's like, he's done live streams with rappers and musicians and entertainers and stuff, and this is what Islam is. And that's why he wasn't very clear about his belief system, because he's masking an entire mainstream majority of Muslims under this small minority. So that is a danger of misrepresentation. I think that's important to obviously to
that's a big one.
It's a big one, isn't it? Because it's important to then realize, oh, representation might matter, because all these people are going to get the wrong idea of what Islam is if I don't represent Islam properly and how it should be. So sometimes you do have to enter those arenas and those spaces. And
that's something like frustrating, isn't it?
So annoying, yeah.
Like literally any Muslim on TV is not, we're like, that's not us.
Yeah.
Whether they're super liberal, super extreme in one way or another.
Yeah. One of them, like I couldn't stay too long on his Instagram because I was just getting annoyed because I was like, how am I going to deal with this? But one of them was like, it was on a radio show and he was talking about how Muslims need to be patriotic to Britain and like stuff about the army and stuff. And then he goes, the prophet, peace be upon him, he encouraged everybody, and it was like he made it mandatory or something to love your country and all this stuff. And I was like, what are you talking about? Like, where's that coming from? Do you know what I mean? Love your country. Like, I don't know what you're talking about. Like, where's that come from? That just seems very convenient, you know? Very convenient to pull that out of thin air and say that just because it fits the context of what you're talking about.
He specifically said, love your nation state.
Love your nation state. This one with the borders.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. So, yeah, there is agendas there, bro. There are agendas. There's people that are going to... I mean, it happens on the extreme end of things, doesn't it? With terrorist groups, with extremists, whatever. Oh, we are the Muslims and look what we're doing and all the crimes they commit. And meanwhile, sometimes, when we do stay silent and we don't represent ourselves properly, I don't know. You know, some people do have a very blasé attitude towards da'wah and they're like, oh, I don't care. If they want to be guided, so what? If they want to know the truth. But if someone's running around waving your flag in the name of Allah and the name of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's religion, so to speak... He's just going to let them do that.
I mean, amidst all this, loads of people joining the religion, you know.
Of course. But then also loads of people, obviously I don't know the numbers, but loads of people also joining very weird fringe groups of religion that don't necessarily.
Yeah. I mean, what matters is where you end up, and where you end up, from what I understand, is based on your sincerity, you know, Salman al-Farsi kind of style, where you go through like five different religions till you find the right one.
Yeah,
and because of your sincerity, Allah will allow you to keep going and keep living until you find that end state of Islam, you know.
Mm.
And so people might start as whatever, Shia, Ahmadi, but with their sincerity, they become, you know, actual Muslim kind of thing. Inshallah. And, you know, as they say, I don't know if this is definitely true, but you know, you hear this, that after 9/11 there was a spike of people joining Islam, becoming Muslim. And so it's like those who are sincere, inshallah, they can see through the kind of media circus and find the truth. And there's more truth available than ever in terms of access, right? If you just, you know, bro, can you imagine how many people are finding the true message of Islam just through YouTube? Like, must be quite good. Alhamdulillah.
Yeah, I think, you're right. Sometimes you have to balance your frustration. It's like what we said last episode. Remember what we said last episode about getting a bit angry online and just raging at people and just writing whatever and stuff, when actually you just have to take a step back and realize your sphere of influence is your sphere of influence. And that's what you have to focus on. Mm-hmm. The people around you, your colleagues, you know, someone wants to have a conversation about Islam to you, you talk to them about it. If you get angry about every single person on TV or online or whatever misrepresenting Islam, that's someone else's responsibility. That's the other Muslim that's in that sphere to challenge and to talk about, you know. So, you know, may Allah allow us and empower us to do what's right in all of these situations and help us and aid us to navigate these difficult situations sometimes, because that's the most important one, isn't it?
Yes, definitely, man. Okay, this episode was based purely on an email from a listener, so... thank you for that. And if you would like your comments, your suggestions, your questions to enter the podcast, then contact us. Go to mindhousepodcast.com. And with that, we'll end, inshallah. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam.